What's up, Manna Church? Welcome, and thanks for tuning in. My name's Nick. I'll be your host today, and this week we're diving into part three of our sermon series called It's Complicated. This has actually been a great series so far. I'm really excited, and I truly believe that God has something for you today. Also, later on, we're going to take some communion together. Listen, we may be separated by location right now, but if you follow Jesus, then we are one in body, talking about the body of Christ. So I want to invite you to participate with us. Just grab something to eat and something to drink. It doesn't have to be anything official. It can be bread and juice or coffee and a donut or whatever you have in the kitchen. The truth is, it doesn't matter what you're eating. What matters is what it represents. So go ahead, get that ready. But for right now, let's take a moment to posture our hearts in worship as we sing a few songs together.
Hey, what's up, Manna family? So glad that you took the time to join us. Would you worship with us?
Who am I that the highest King would welcome me? I was lost, but he brought me in through his love for me. Oh, his love for me.
Yes, I
Amen. Aren't you glad that the presence of God isn't confined by walls or a building or any specific location? And that's why we can experience the presence of God wherever we're at, wherever you're watching this. And that's good news for us. Listen, again, I just want to say welcome. We really are glad to have you with us here today, especially if this is your first time tuning in to Manna Online. If that's you, then you're our guest today, and we'd love to connect with you. Let us know that you tuned in by texting the word guest to the number on your screen right now. Go ahead, even if you have to pause the video, feel free to do that, that's okay. And if you happen to be watching on our website, manna.church, then you can either text the number, or we have a fancy little button beneath the video box that you can click that says first time guest. We made that just for you. Or maybe this isn't your first time to Manna Online. Maybe you've never texted the number, but you've tuned in plenty of times. Well, let me tell you, it's that time. Today's the day. Text the number already. The water's fine. Come on in. We just want to connect with you and see how we can serve you best. Also, maybe you came prepared to give today, and if that's you, we want to say thank you. Here's a couple of easy ways that you can do that. You can do that on our website, manna.church, or even through the Manna Church app. Or you can text the number that you see on the screen, give through PayPal that way. Or if you have something physical that you'd like to send us, feel free to mail us or drop it off at our offices at the Cliffdale site of the Fayetteville, Fort Bragg region. I also want to just say, if you are a guest today, if this is your first time tuning in, please feel no obligation to give. Let's pray. God, we are so grateful for who you are. God, thank you that you are Jehovah Jireh. You're our provider. So Lord, we respond in worship right now by giving. Really giving what you say is already yours, but we ask that you would take everything that's given, bless it, multiply it to advance your kingdom literally to the ends of the earth. In Jesus' name we pray, amen. Let's jump back into worship.
Oh Jesus, I'll put my trust in you. Worthy of every song we could ever sing. Worthy of all the praise we could ever bring. Worthy of every breath we could ever breathe. We live for you, oh Jesus. Jesus, the name above every other name. Jesus, the only one who could ever save. Worthy of every breath we could ever breathe. We live for you. We live for you. For holy, there is no one. There is none beside you. Open up my eyes and wonder. Show me who you are and fill me with your heart and lead me in your love to those around me. Oh, you're so worthy. Every song we could ever sing, yeah. Worthy of all the praise we could ever bring. Worthy of every breath we could ever breathe. We live for you. Oh, we live for you, Jesus. Jesus, the name above every other name. Jesus, the only one who could ever save. You're so worthy, worthy of every breath we could ever breathe. We live for you. We live for you. You trust in you. Sing it out. For I will build my life upon your love. It is a firm foundation. I will put my trust in you alone, and I will not be shaken. For I
You know, as I mentioned earlier, we're going to take communion together during this worship experience. So I want to encourage you, if you've decided to follow Jesus, participate with us. Go ahead and grab those elements that I told you about. Again, it doesn't have to be official. You can grab some bread and juice or even coffee and a donut. Really, it doesn't matter what you grab, because what it represents is more important. What it represents is the body of Jesus and the blood of Jesus. You know, when Jesus, he came to the earth and he left us with some things, some traditions that we call sacraments, one of which is called communion. And to this day, all believers, we take communion remembering what Jesus did on the cross for us, his body that was broken for us, his blood that was shed for us. So whatever you have to eat, go ahead and grab that right now. I've just got a little wafer, but this represents Jesus's body that was broken for us. You know, his body was broken so that we can experience wholeness. Let's take this right now. Jesus, thank you for your sacrifice. Thank you for going to the cross. We remember your work on the cross. And right now we thank you that you bore stripes on your back so that we can be healed. And we take this in remembrance of you. Go ahead and grab whatever you've got to drink. I've just got some juice here, but again, it doesn't matter, because what this represents is the blood of Jesus. Let's pray together. Jesus, again, we do thank you for your sacrifice, and thank you for your blood that was shed for us. There is power in your blood. Thank you that your blood washes us clean, makes us right with God, so that we can experience life and life abundantly, eternally with you. We take this in remembrance of you. Go ahead and drink. You know, Scripture tells us that every time we do this, take communion, the the bread and the juice or whatever it is you have. Every time we do this, we proclaim the Lord's death until he returns. So God, we come to you right now and we look forward to the day that you come back. But we don't look so forward to the day that we sit on our hands and do nothing. No, first of all, we look to the cross and we say, thank you for your sacrifice. Thank you for healing us from our past, redeeming us in our present, and propelling us into our future. We look forward to the plans and the purposes that you have for us individually and corporately as the church. Have your way. May we forcefully advance your kingdom until you return. In Jesus' name. Amen. Listen, we are about ready to dive into part three of our sermon series. It's complicated, but before we do, check out these video announcements.
Well, it's here. Serve Day is today. In just a few hours, we're coming together to be the church and serve our neighbors right here in the Fayetteville, Fort Bragg region. We want them to experience the love of Jesus with no strings attached. Don't worry, if you've not signed up just yet, there's still time to sign up and serve. Go to the Manna Church app, the website, manna.church, or the Connection Center at your site. Manna Church, you are a force. Together, let's get out there and love the world. See you right back here this afternoon.
Hey everybody, Pastor Michael here. Just want to take a couple of minutes to talk about why Laura and I are so high on our internship program, also called The Experience. Because every single person has a calling from God. You know that, we know that. It's one of our foundational ideas. So we take your students and help them develop a strong platform of faith, leadership, and character. Faith, leadership, and character. Why? So when they go out into the workplace or they go off to college, they have a firm foundation. They're ready to manage it. They're ready to handle it. Not only that, you get rewarded as you go. They're mentors along the way. Listen, I love it. I mentor them every single week that I'm home. It's amazing to see the ideas that are in them in the beginning, how they get formed as they mature. It is so cool to watch. You got some of the greatest kids on the planet. We just want to help you with them. We want to help them become successful in life. And so not only are they rewarded by having time with great leaders, not me, but the other great leaders on our staff, but they get rewarded as they go. They get college credit. What's cool is that by the time you finish that one-year internship, you got 30 hours of college underneath your belt, and you're ready to rock and roll. It's so exciting, and we are so enthusiastic about it. We put our two youngest in it. Now they're both working in fields where they feel like they're called. They've graduated college, they're working on their master's, all in their 20s. Listen, that can be your future. So you're wondering, how do I get involved? Just text the number you see on your screen and join us for Info Night. God bless you. See you there.
What's going on, Manna Online? This is Emory Anderson, also known as Pastor M, and it's so good to be with you all today. I'm excited about what God is going to speak through our message today, but I'm just as excited because today I'm joined by my beautiful wife, Jessica. Jessica, say hi to the folks on Manna Online.
Hello, everybody.
And by the time we're recording this, I don't know when you'll see this, but it's her birthday weekend, right? So a production, go ahead and drop her Cash App on the screen in case someone wants to treat us to dinner.
I'm just playing.
Nah, go ahead. Y'all go ahead and put it on there. But today we are continuing in our sermon series entitled, It's Complicated, Keeping It Together. And I bet someone is watching online right now and your Facebook relationship status is probably set to It's Complicated and you're trying to figure out that very thing, how to keep it together. But guess what? This series is for you. And speaking of birthdays, a couple of weeks ago, we went to see my grandmother who lives in Wilmington, Delaware. And it's been a while since we've seen her, you know, challenges and COVID in 2020, of course. So it's been close to about 3 years, and she doesn't do real well with FaceTime. But her birthday was on June 30th, and mine was on July 1st. So we wanted to go up there and surprise her for our birthdays. And so Jessica called one of my aunts, and they planned a surprise dinner for her, invited family. And we were coming to show up to dinner as a surprise. Like, we're just going to show up and be like, surprise.
Now, I told Emory, that sounds good in theory.
Right.
But she's older. She just turned 85 this year. And although popping up at the dinner would be a pleasant surprise when she sees us, we would like for her to be shocked and not go into shock.
Right, right. That's a good point.
Right. So we altered the plan a little bit. And Emory called her while we were on the way. We were maybe an hour away, so she couldn't go to the market and buy stuff. So we just wanted her to really just relax and be surprised. And it was still a surprise because she didn't know until about an hour beforehand. And she loved every moment of it. It was such a wonderful time. But the reason I mentioned that to Emory is because I know everyone doesn't like surprises, and we all react to them differently. For those of you who may be like me, I like to know what's happening, where we are going, and who's going to be there, because that will definitely determine if I'm at the function or not.
She ain't lying, y'all. Man, online, she ain't lying. But she's right. For many people, the thought of not knowing the answer to something or not knowing what's about to happen next can terrify them. There's a quote by actress Tracy Ellis Ross that says, "As a younger person, my philosophy was to jump off the cliff, like a leap of faith. I realize now that there are stairs and elevators, and I'm learning every day to allow the space between where I am and where I want to be to inspire me and not terrify me. I can even ask for help, not feeling like I have to know everything." And that's where the growth comes in the not knowing. I love that. So look, wherever you're watching from today online, I need you to say this. Even if you're by yourself, I need you to say this. I don't know. And guess what? It's okay not to know sometimes. And you can say it. I bet some of you right now, some of you parents, you're probably pretty ecstatic that your kids are going back to school in person this year because you didn't want them to know that you really are not that good in math. Well, all you had to do was say, "Son, guess what? I don't really know." Maybe you want to ask your mama. Right. But you know what's crazy when I think about it? Or should I say what's amazing when I think about it, the numerous times in my life and in our life where in those uncertain times, we saw the hand of God moving in those uncertain seasons. Think about marriage. Like this year, we're celebrating 10 years of marriage. Hey, praise God, somebody. but neither one of us had been married. And so that was new. And adjusting there, becoming a pastor. Yeah. That was definitely new for us as well as me. I was Michael Fletcher's assistant for 2.5 years. And for two of those years, I was telling him, "Hey, I don't believe God has called me to be a pastor, but you see where I am and you see how that turned out." Right, right, right.
Right.
And just those who've been following our journey, who knows about my wife's health conditions when it kind of took a turn that was not so good. But then now we're back in this season where we're in this season of healing and recovery. All of this was unknown territory and was uncertain. But that's the thing. Life is full of uncertainties. Our relationships are full of uncertainties. Dating is full of uncertainties. Marriage is always going to have its uncertainties. Right. And I'm not talking about whether or not you're certain if you're going to be together or not. Right. Sometimes it's just trying to figure out what you're going to have for dinner
tonight. Hardest thing
I know that's difficult for us. Like, we're uncertain probably what we're going to eat tonight, you know. Right. But many times we're simply trying to figure that out. Parenting, beginning at a new school, a new job, joining a sports team, maybe a doctor visit, and you're waiting for a report. It all has its uncertainties. But the thing that is for certain is that in this life, you will face uncertainties.
Absolutely. And knowing that can make our relationships complicated. You may think to yourself, "Why put the time into this relationship if I don't know if it's going to work out? Why get close and become friends when I know we are going to be leaving again in a few years?" And these questions arise for the simple fact that relationships, because they involve people, can be complicated.
Right.
But they don't always have to be. A lot of times we make them complicated.
Right.
So our prayer and our hope in this series is to share with you some ideas and some practices to help manage many of the challenges you may face in your relationships when it gets complicated and help you keep it together.
Yeah.
So in week one of this series, we discuss managing money in your relationships. Yeah. Week two, we discuss managing expectations in your relationships. If you missed either one of those, you could go online on the app or mannachurch.com. Today, we want to look at managing uncertainty in your relationship.
That's right. And so I believe our time today is going to be a special time, because in preparing for this sermon, we sense God just leading us to be very transparent and vulnerable. Just the last 5 years of our life, just that season and what that's looked like, has had its uncertainties. It's been a roller coaster ride. It's had its ups and its downs. But one thing I can tell you, if nothing else, that in this time of uncertainty is that God was God, meaning he was who he says he was going to be, and he does what he says he would do. So we're compelled today to share with you how we manage that season of uncertainty. And also what we want to do, too, is we're going to look at some of the uncertainties in the story of Joseph. So we'll share our story of how we went through this process of kidney transplant to now being on the other side. Praise God. My wife received her kidney February 6th of this year. Yeah. Yay. Praise God for that. You can drop some claps in the comment section. So we want to share and be vulnerable and transparent and share that story. But we also want to draw some parallels from the story of Joseph. So in your own study time, in your own prayer time, you can go back and look at that story and have those points for you. And in doing that, we want to go through that, and we want to give you six for certains in managing uncertainty. Six for certains in managing uncertainty. And so the first for certain is acknowledge the product of the presence. Acknowledge the product of the presence. So just kind of giving a little backstory at Joseph's story. If we look at Joseph in scripture, it tells us that he was his father's favorite child, and his half brothers hated him because of it. Like they wouldn't even talk to him. And Joseph, he was a dreamer. The Bible tells us he was a dreamer and he had dreams. And so he told his brothers this particular dream, and just kind of in a nutshell, the dream consisted of them kind of bowing down and serving him, and that didn't sit well with them. The idea of them bowing down to Joseph and him ruling over them didn't sit very well with his brother. So they plotted to kill him. They were going to take him out. But instead, you know, they sold him into a life of servitude to some Ishmaelites, and he ended up finding himself in Egypt. And Joseph was acquired by Potiphar, who was like the manager of Pharaoh's household. And we'll pick up here in scripture, chapter 39 in Genesis, verses 2 through 6. Genesis 39, it reads, "The Lord was with Joseph, and he became a successful man, and he was in the house of the Egyptian master. His master saw that the Lord was with him, and that the Lord caused all that he did to succeed in his hands. So Joseph found favor in his sight and attended him, and he made him overseer of his house, and he put him in charge of all that he had. From the time that he made him overseer in his house, and over all that he had, the Lord blessed the Egyptian's house for Joseph's sake. The blessing of the Lord was on all that he had in the house and field. So he left all that he had in Joseph's charge. And because of him, he had no concern about anything but the food he ate." And there is so much that we can unpack in this text here. Like, we could just look at the first few verses. I mean, we could stop at the first five words: "The Lord was with Joseph." And we know his brothers plotted his demise. He was sold into servitude, a life of servitude, found himself in a foreign land, but the Lord was with Joseph. And I love how the text tells us that the master saw that the Lord was with Joseph, and because the Lord was with him, everything he put his hands to, he was successful. And Potiphar was able to see this as the product of the presence and God being with Joseph. Don't you know, when God is present in your circumstances, when God is present in your marriage, when God is present in your decision making, in the choices you make, in your work, in your conversations, even in the most uncertain and complicated times, you still can see, if you look around, you still can see and find his imprints of his presence and his hand at work. And we know this to be true in our own lives.
Oh, absolutely.
Right.
We've walked into doctor's appointments like, "Nope, nope. I heard what you said, doc." And we respect that. But we know who the chief physician is. And some of what you're saying doesn't line up what he has said to us. But the only way we were able to move like this was because we knew that, just like the Lord was with Joseph, the Lord was with Emory and I.
Right, right.
And I can share a personal experience that we've had with this. When I got the call for a transplant, I was on my way home from dialysis, and we had to hurry up, pack everything up, and hit the road immediately. And so, you know, you think that it's going to be one way, and then, you know, it turns out something totally different from what you even expected. And so when we got there, I got in my hospital room, I got checked in, nurse asked me all these questions. And then the doctor comes in and says, you know, he explains all this stuff about the kidney, the donor, all these different things. And then he says, well, you know, the first time someone gets a call, it's usually a test run.
Mm-hmm. I remember that, yeah.
Test run? I'm not here for no test run. And so, you know, everyone told me that. This is a test run. You may go home and you may not get a kidney. And me and Emory are like, no, we're getting this kidney because we know what we prayed for.
Right.
So you can cast your uncertainty upon me all you want, but I am certain that this is a kidney that I'm going to get, and this is not a test run.
That's right.
At all. And so I ended up getting that kidney, and it wasn't a test run. And we knew that it was not going
right,
to be a
exactly.
test run, because that's not
exactly.
what I signed up for.
Exactly.
When you move and live by faith, you can be comforted by the certainty and the blessing of God's presence in your life when walking into and facing uncertainty.
Absolutely.
In Psalms verses 46, verses 1 through 3, it reads, God is our refuge and strength, a very present help in trouble. Therefore, we will not fear though the earth gives way, though the mountains be moved into the heart of the sea, though its waters roar and foam, though the mountains tremble at its swelling.
That's good. Like, disaster may be present, but guess what? So is God. And this psalm reminds us of the fact that God will shield us and protect us and be a covering in our time of trouble. And isn't that an amazing thing to know, to comfort us in uncertain times? And so that brings us to our second for certain, which is turn from temptation. Turn from temptation. And when I say turn, what I mean is run, flee, get up out of there, bounce, however you want to paraphrase that, flee from it, get away from it. And Joseph reacts or rejects temptation strongly, literally fleeing from sexual sin. And at this point, Joseph has grown into a good looking man, and he's very successful. And come on, a good looking man, hardworking, God fearing. You can't tell me that's not attractive, right? Right?
Woo!
Right? You know, so, and I know the ladies, y'all dropping the amens in the comment section online. Go ahead and drop them praise hands. But Joseph, this is what I love about Joseph here, is that he doesn't allow his position and his success to allow him to become complacent toward sin. Even as a man of position in his master's house, he puts God above all.
Right.
And we see this when Potiphar's wife, you know, she tried to push up on him a little bit. And so she asked Joseph to lie with her. He says no, so she lies on him to her husband. And so here's Joseph's response to this invitation, Genesis 39, verses 8 through 9. But he refused and said to his master's wife, behold, because of me, my master has no concern about anything in the house, and he has put everything that he has in my charge. He is not greater in this house than I am, nor has he kept back anything from me except you, because you are his wife. How then can I do this great wickedness and sin against God? And if we read on, we find out that this wife, she's a little aggressive to the point where, like, Joseph, he's like, there's no more explaining and talking to this lady. He has to get up out of there. So he bounces, he runs, and she's, you know, she has a hold of his cloak. And so she has his clothes, his cloak, his garments with her. So essentially now she has the evidence to go and tell her husband that Joseph tried to push up on me. And I mean, her husband believes her. Joseph, he gets thrown into prison. And so Potiphar is Joseph's master, but he didn't have a worry in the world when Joseph was in charge. And so even, here's the thing, even in this, if Joseph had a weak moment with his position in the house, he probably could have got away with this and Potiphar never would have known. But for Joseph, it wasn't about Potiphar knowing or sinning against Potiphar. For him, it was about him knowing that he would be sinning against God. 1 Corinthians says in chapter 10, verse 13, no temptation has overtaken you that is not common to man. God is faithful, and he will not let you be tempted beyond your ability. But with the temptation, he will also provide the way of escape that you may be able to endure. Listen, temptation will come in many forms, not just sexual advances, but God provides us a way out. And the more we resist temptation and turn from it, the more we're able to endure it. So in those times where things look uncertain, don't give in to the temptation of doubting God and not believing God at his word and try to force something or make something work yourself. Turn from temptation and turn towards God.
Yes. The third for certain is keep your faith on flex.
Yes.
Keep your faith on flex.
Like that.
This simply means to keep your faith, what you stand for and what you believe in, on display for others to see.
Yeah.
There's tremendous power in the witness of God, mm-hmm. whether it be with your words or with your walk.
Yeah, that's good.
And I'll give you two examples of this in my life, in the transplant journey. One being that I had this dialysis technician, and I would tell her, you know, I'm not going to be here for a long time. And, you know, she would look at me like I'm crazy, like, mm-hmm. you know, yeah, yeah, they all say that. Yeah, this is what we you. Always hear. Mm-hmm. Yeah, no, she didn't hear
she
me. She didn't know me either.
She know,
and so, okay. One day she said, you know, so-and-so has been here for 10 years and they still don't have a transplant.
Yeah.
And so-and-so has been here for 22 years and they still haven't gotten a transplant.
Right, right.
And I looked at her and I said, well, what'd you say the first person's name? And, you know, she repeated it.
Yeah, uh-huh.
And then I said, what'd you say that second person's name was? And then she repeated the second name. And I said, well, neither of those names sound like Jessica Anderson. I'm telling you that I'm not going to be here for a long time.
Right.
And then I said, you know what? God's going to have to show you better than I could ever tell you.
It gotta happen like that sometimes. That,
some people, right. it has to happen that way.
Right.
And then another story that I could never plan out in this way ever. It was all a God thing. From the very beginning, I had a nephrologist, which is a kidney doctor, who I was never supposed to have.
Right.
People questioned me, you know, how'd you end up with this doctor? How you end up with this doctor? I'm like, I don't know. That's who they sent me to. So that's who I went with. And so she was in another part of the transplant department, and so I was not supposed to have her because I hadn't yet had a transplant. Mm-hmm. But this doctor, she carried me through. If I ever had any questions, if I doubted what my other doctors were saying, she was the first person that I would call. She would guide me, tell me things that I needed to do, or say, nope, that doctor doesn't know what he's talking about. That's not what you need to do. This is what you need to do. So she had my back hardcore.
Yeah.
And so she was my support in that arena all throughout transplant. And when I started dialysis, I started with peritoneal dialysis, which I started at home. The same week, the same day that I started dialysis, my nurse, Joe, started with this company at the same exact clinic on the very same day that I started dialysis. Mm. Joe was a big support. He would, you know, do all the things he could. And one day he said, Jessica, you know, you should probably get listed at Charlotte. Because I've seen a lot of people get transplanted at Charlotte. At the time, Charlotte was the only transplant hospital that was not listed with all the other transplant hospitals in North Carolina.
That's right.
So they did not have to share any of their kidneys. They kept them all in-house. And so Joe, he signed me up. He transferred all my paperwork. He did all the legwork for that. And so I was then on Charlotte's transplant list. And in that time that I was waiting for a call, I was notified that Charlotte's transplant list would be merged with the other three hospitals in North Carolina. And so all of the hospitals would have to share their transplants. And so, you know, there's a heavy little feeling like, oh, I don't want this to happen.
Right.
And so it was supposed to happen in December of 2020.
It
was supposed to happen December 2020.
Yeah.
But it was delayed. And so they pushed it back to February. And so I'm like, okay, I still have some time here before they're listed. I got transplanted on February the 6th. And on February the 8th, Charlotte merged with every single hospital in North Carolina.
Wow.
I could never set that up own or that happen any other way but God walking with me and putting the people in my life at the seasons, the very right seasons that they needed to be there.
That's crazy.
And so I'm forever thankful to those two for, you know, carrying me and getting me to the finish line.
So good.
So in Hebrews chapter 1 verses 11 says, now faith is the certainty of things hoped for, a proof of things not seen.
Man, that's so good, man. And if we look at Joseph's story in parallel, you know, he is stuck in this season of grief and disappointment, but by the strength of God, he presses on to walk and be productive while he's in Egypt, even in prison. Remember, now he's in prison. And so we see the same favor he had with Potiphar in his master's house, he has with the prison guard in prison. Like, he's a prisoner, but now he oversees other prisoners and what happens in prison. It's crazy. And the witness of Joseph's walk was so strong that wherever he found himself, whoever he came in contact with, and whatever circumstance he may have found himself in, it was evident that God was with him. And you'll be surprised by the number of husbands or even single guys that have reached out to me and say, hey, man, Pastor M, you a solid dude, man. Like, I commend you. I respect you for holding your wife down in this season. I know some guys who would have folded or they might have would have bounced, so they wouldn't have been able to do that. And, I mean, the first thing I'm thinking, like, well, who you hanging around? You know what I'm saying? So that's the first thing popped in my mind. And so, and here's the thing. I can't take credit for that. Like, I know it was nothing but the grace of God, the love of Jesus, and the power of the Holy Spirit working through me. But the thing is, I'm not that strong, but in my weakness, his strength is made perfect. And in me walking out that sacrificial love towards you and just kind of letting people know our story, it didn't point people to us to say, hey, look how I'm holding her down. Look at me. But it was allowing people to see God, rather see God when they see us and his hand at work. And so as we're looking back at Joseph's story during his time in prison, you know, he connects with a few people. He interprets some dreams of two fellow prisoners. There's a baker who he lets them know, hey, your dream saying you're going to get whacked. You're not making cupcakes ever again. Then there's a cupbearer who he's saying, hey, you're going to be restored back to your position. And so it plays out this way, just as Joseph says. But he tells the cupbearer, look, when you're restored, like, let him know about your boy Joseph. Like, hey, I'm down here. Let him know I'm interpreting dreams. And like, look out for your boy. So he gets up there. 2 years go by and the cupbearer says nothing. It takes Pharaoh having to have a dream that nobody can interpret for him to be like, you know what, Pharaoh? When I forgot right. to mention when I was in prison, I met this dude, Joseph. Right. He interpreting dreams. We might want to call him up. And so they do. They call Joseph up and he interprets the dreams. And you got to imagine what Joseph is going through. Like, he's been sold into slavery. His brothers initially plotted to kill him. He's in a foreign land and he's sitting for 2 years where it's like, God, you've been with me in all of these things. And now, like, I'm in this place of uncertainty and I'm just sitting
right.
like nothing is happening. And so they call Joseph up. He interprets Pharaoh's dreams. And we see that Pharaoh acknowledges God's power when he interprets the dream, saying, can we find a man like this in whom is the spirit of God? Pharaoh and his boys, they were pleased with the interpretation of Joseph, the dream that he interpreted. And now Joseph is elevated to a position higher than what he had before he went into prison. Remember, before he was overseer of his master's house. Now he's overseer of all the land of Egypt. And all this took place because Joseph kept his faith on flex. And by doing so, he allowed God's might to be right. on display.
Absolutely. The fourth for certain is shift your view in the valley.
Man, I love that.
Without
love
ever that. Having to stand on the mountaintop or find yourself in a valley low, it is obvious that the view from the other is very different. Mm-hmm. When in the valleys of life, it's easy to look at and fixate on the challenges and uncertainties ahead and what it's going to take to get out of those lows
right.
and up to the mountaintop.
Yeah.
But at the mountaintop, you're able to look down and look back at the journey it took to get there, and you appreciate the mountaintop experience all the more.
So true.
And an illustration of this would be a child who has played outside in the North Carolina heat and Ooh. Humidity and is thirsty. You know, dry mouth, just hot, just yeah. ugh, over it.
Sticky.
That child, he is looking at a glass filled 50% with water because he's thirsty. That child sees a glass as half empty because the more water is desired.
Yeah.
That same child who has to finish his or her glass of water before they have any juice sees the same glass as half full because less water in the glass is more desirable,
That's
of
good.
Course, so he can get his apple juice,
get that juice,
you know,
right,
whatever
right.
he wants. Many times we desire for our circumstance to change because it's uncomfortable for us. And because of uncertainty, we miss or fail to see what God is doing in the midst of it. So what actually needs to change is not the circumstance, but our perspective.
Mm-hmm.
And a lot of times I would get asked, you know, how do you do it? And how do you not look like what you're going through? And how do you, you know, maintain and be positive and you're not depressed? And I would just simply say, it's my perspective on it.
Yeah.
And so I can look at my situation. I can look at it as not fortunate. Like, this is unfair. This is messed up. But I could change nothing about it.
Sure.
I had to walk through it in order for it to change. There was nothing on my part that I can do about my circumstances. But the one thing I could do was change my response to it.
That's good.
So I had to shift my perspective and say, Lord, you know, I may have to go to dialysis every day, but thank you that I don't need a heart because dialysis, it gives me a chance to live.
Mm.
while waiting on this organ versus a heart or a liver, a lung. So those things are very immediate, you know, needs because you can't live without those things. And I was just thankful that I had an opportunity to go to dialysis, although it sucked. I hated every moment of it. But at the same time, that's what I could do in order to not see my situation as negative. I was still able to live life in the terms that I could. Was it what I wanted? No, but I was happy in the moment that I was able to do something despite my circumstance.
That's so good, man. I love this woman. Y'all see why. I love this woman. And here's the thing. So looking at Joseph's story, remember, we're running these parallels. There's a part in Joseph's story that I haven't heard. I don't hear a lot of times in messages that talk about Joseph's text. But for the context of this message, I really love this. It stood out to me as I was studying and preparing. And I found it very significant. And it's in Genesis 41. We're giving the names of Joseph's children along with what they mean and why he chose those names. So check this out. Genesis 41, verses 51 through 52. Joseph called the name of his firstborn Manasseh, for he said, God has made me forget all of my hardship and all my father's house. The name of the second he called Ephraim, for God has made me fruitful in the land of my affliction. Wow. Wow, like you gotta love this. Here we see Joseph naming his children in reflection of God's grace and favor at work in his life. He's showing his gratitude for the Lord's kindness despite the pain from his past. For me, this is the view shift happening in the valley. There's no bitterness here, just gratefulness in his heart. When we can look at something despite the hell that has taken us through, but we can call out what God says it is and not what man says it is, like that's powerful. Your viewpoint, the trajectory takes a whole new direction. Like when you can look at sickness and say, I see healing. You can look at chaos in your life and say, no, I see peace. Right. You can look at mourning or have mourning, experiencing mourning and say, no, I see dancing coming. I see rejoicing. You can look at loss and say, no, restoration is coming. You can experience setback and say, no, sir, I see setup. God is setting me up for something great. And I love how God just moves in this way. I believe, you know, they can try to label your kids something in school and you say, no, my kids will be successful in school. They will be successful in college, and you can begin to project these things because you know that God's hand is at move. You can be met by words that are condemning, but you say, guess what? No. I can meet Jesus at the cross. That's powerful if you can change that perspective. If we could allow our perspective and our view in the uncertain and in the difficult times to change, I believe God can and he will show himself to us in ways like never before.
Yes. That's real good. And our fifth for certain is in the trial, he can be trusted.
Yes, he can.
God is sovereign and faithful. God knows what we need and what we don't need way before we even realize it. So again, kidney process is a journey and it's a crazy journey. So I remember that we had three people who were matches and got down to the very last phase. And for whatever reason, they couldn't get over the hump of being approved. So those were my, like, you know, those were very up and down moments because, you know, you have someone who's willing to help you and give one of their own kidneys to you. But then it's just like, you know, it's a little downing when, you know, that person can't get over the hump to be approved. But it wasn't until about 4 years into my process of being on dialysis that I had learned that the condition that caused my kidney disease, if I would not have solved that issue, it would have been detrimental to a new kidney.
Wow.
So although I was sad and upset that those people didn't get approved, God knew all along, like, hey, you still have some work that needs to be done before I will bless you with this kidney. And so that procedure, it just had to happen for my kidney to last the length, because had it not, it would have been destroyed in a very short amount of time, and I would have been right back at square one on dialysis. We didn't know that,
right,
but God knew that the entire time. And he set it up to where, you know, we were disappointed. We might have been angry at times. We were hurt, but we never doubted God.
Right.
We never doubted God's plans. We never doubted God's steps for us. We just didn't always understand the path he was taking us on in the journey. Mm. And I was reminded of Proverbs chapter 3, verses 5 that says, trust in the Lord with all your heart and do not lean on your own understanding, because it will not make sense.
That's so good.
None whatsoever.
That's so good. Looking back at Joseph, one of the most impactful truths from Joseph's testimony is that God works in ways higher than our own. We may experience momentary affliction, but God uses it to prepare blessing and glory in the future, either on earth or in eternity. And Joseph understands this, allowing him to respond well in a difficult time. We see this in Genesis 45, verses 5 through 6. And now do not be distressed or angry with yourselves because you sold me here. For God, he's talking to his brothers, for God sent me before you to preserve life. For the famine has been in the land these 2 years, and there are yet 5 years in which there will be neither plowing nor harvest. Joseph has now encountered his brothers as overseer of all of Egypt, and the very dream he shared with them years ago has come to pass. He consoles them by telling them not to beat themselves up about it, because it had to take place. It had to happen in order for God's plan to come to fruition, to preserve the life in the land. He could have been bitter. He had the power to return many times over what they had done to him. But Joseph understood that this was all God's doing. How he chose to respond to the strained relationship he had with his brother says a lot about the character of Joseph as well, which brings us to our last for certain, which is put away the past. Simply put, forgiveness goes further. Joseph demonstrates his understanding of God's sovereignty and grace by sharing it with his brothers. He demonstrates this by not returning evil for evil, but humbly moving past his brother's sin and treating them with kindness. Genesis 50, verses 18 and 21. His brothers also came and fell down before him and said, behold, we are your servants. But Joseph said to them, do not fear, for I am in the place of God. As for you, you meant evil against me, but God meant it for my good. Isn't it so good when God turns around what the enemy means for evil for us? So do not fear. I will provide for you and your little ones. Thus, he comforted them and spoke kindly to them. Joseph could have been a complete jerk right here. Like, seriously. I know many of us, if we were in that same position, it might not have gone the exact same way as we're reading in scripture. Like, people would have gotten a different you before you met Jesus if this was the scenario. Let's keep it real. But Joseph sees the bigger picture. He realized that if it had to play out this way, for God to be able to put him where he needed to be in this very moment in order to save the land from the famine. And so Joseph chooses to forgive and put away the pain from his past.
Absolutely. It's so important in relationships that we have today. I had some middle school childhood friends, and we have been friends since middle school all the way up until adulthood. Both of those friendships actually hit a tough spot where we stopped talking. We didn't contact each other. There was misunderstanding, some miscommunication. If I have to admit, there was a little bit of pride between the both of us on both sides. But there were things that happened in life, but with their life and my life. And we began to realize the reasons why we value this person, and that they carried more weight than the minor thing of us that had us not talking. So we forgave each other. We got on the phone, both of the friends and I, we got on the phone. We forgave one another. We made amends. And those are the absolute strongest friendships that I have currently in my life today. And imagine me holding a grudge and not going there and doing nothing and talking to those people. They have been my circle, along with Emory. They've been my rocks, my support system when it came everything with the journey transition. So that fellowship and the friendships that I needed in a tough season, I would still be missing out on had I not grown and said, hey, like, we need to fix this.
So good. The past can hold us back from enjoying the right now and fully experiencing what God has for us in the future. Relationships are tough because people are flawed and no two people are created alike. That mixed with doing life with others and it is bound to create some challenges. When you factor in money, expectations, uncertainty, kids, and life, transitions in your relationships, they can get a little bit complicated. But as we continue through this series, our hope is that each week you can leave feeling like you are a bit more equipped in managing these things and keeping it all together. Let's pray. Father, we thank you for our time together online today. We pray that you will continue to walk with us, continue to lead us in our relationships. May your presence be with us in those relationships, in those conversations, in those difficult and uncertain times. Help us to turn from temptation. Give us people in our life to hold us accountable. Will you allow us to be bold in allowing our faith to be on flex, to witness to others, whether it be through our words or through our walk, to see you in our daily activities. Help us to shift our view in the valley, in the dark and hard and difficult, uncertain times, that our eyes may not be fixated on the thing that we see, but we can turn our eyes to you. Help us to trust you in the trials and to forgive and put away the past. In Jesus' name, amen. Wherever you're watching from right now, I'm gonna cut to the chase. You know, we're talking about relationships and uncertainty, and the one relationship that you definitely don't want to be uncertain about is your relationship with your Heavenly Father. You know, there's nothing you can do. There's no act, there's no work that you can do to mend that relationship. The fact is, we're all sinners, and sin is the very thing that separates us from God. And you have to make that decision whether or not you want to spend an eternity separated from God. And so I'm so grateful that God loved us so much that he sent his son Jesus to live the life that we couldn't live, the perfect life that we couldn't live, to take the wrath of the Father, the penalty for sin, on himself in our place. And that exchange is what makes us right with God. By us receiving Jesus in our life and accepting him as our Lord and Savior and choosing to follow him, that bridges that gap. And so you may be watching right now and you know that your relationship with God isn't right. I want to give you an opportunity right now in this space to accept Jesus, to invite him into your heart and become the Lord and Savior in your life and over your life. And so right now, if that's you and you want to accept Jesus into your life, all you need to do is there's a number that's going to pop up on your screen. We're going to pray a prayer together in a little bit. And I want you to text the name Jesus to the number that you see on your screen after we finish praying. We're going to leave it up on the screen. So just repeat after me wherever you are. Say, Father.
Father,
I'm a sinner.
I'm a sinner.
And I've sinned against you.
And I've sinned against you.
I'm sorry.
Sorry.
I repent.
Please forgive me.
Thank you for sending your son Jesus.
Thank you for sending your son Jesus. To die for my sins. Jesus.
Come into my heart.
Change me.
Cleanse me.
Make me new.
And today,
I'll follow you.
And forevermore. In Jesus' name.
Amen.
Praise God, man. We're celebrating with you in this new walk of walking in new life. And so remember, if you prayed that prayer for the first time, text the name Jesus, to the number that you see on your screen. Man, we've had an awesome time with you today. You guys have a blessed week. And remember, join me this week as I'll be leading us through a continued discussion of managing uncertainty in our relationships, in our morning manners, in our newsletter that you'll get, as well as our app. God bless you all.
Awesome. What a powerful message from Pastor M and Jessica. You know, as they concluded the message there, they gave you an opportunity to start a real relationship with Jesus. And I just want to say, if you prayed that prayer, would you text the name Jesus to the number that you see on the screen? Even if you've got to pause this, we want to connect with you. So we want to encourage you to text that number. You're going to receive a text, a response, and it's going to be a prompt. Just follow the instructions that it gives you. You know, this is a super exciting moment of your life, and we at Manna Church, we would love to come alongside you and help you as you begin your personal journey with Jesus. Manna Church, we love you. Thank you again for joining us online today. If you'd like someone to pray with you, take a moment and text the word prayer to the number that you see on the screen. We have a team that's ready and waiting to connect with you and see how we can pray for you in any area of your life. God bless you, Manna Church. We'll see you next week. Me too.
until you found me, showed me who I could be.